And one of the longest running, best known anime and manga franchises still in production today, Lupin III has come a long way since his humble beginnings in 1967. While Lupin has subsequently established himself in the West, most notably through feature film The Castle of Cagliostro, the original 23-episode TV series is still relatively obscure to English-speaking fandom, little seen and unlikely to ever see an official release. As you may have noticed by now, however, I like obscure things. The possibly Japanese grandson of a French master thief, Lupin III is determined to uphold the family name by undertaking an epic quest to liberate valuable objects from their wealthy owners. Aiding him in his adventures are Daisuke Jigen, a sharpshooting former mobster, Goemon Ishikawa, an old-fashioned samurai, and Fujiko Mine, Lupin's on-off lover and frequent rival. Each self-contained episode will generally involve a valuable MacGuffin that Lupin and his gang will attempt to steal in ever more exciting and sexy ways. Or, to be more exact, this is the formula the series will eventually adopt. Lupin's TV debut is effectively split into two sections, and the early part is actually rather different. While it's all undoubtedly the same show, the first eight episodes are darker, pulp novel adventure stories laced with surreal Mad Magazine humour, while the second half is made up of light-hearted, easy-going capers. It's easier to explain this if I talk a bit about the production, so brace yourselves for some historical rambling. Commissioned for TV in 1971, Lupin III started its run as one of the first anime series aimed at an adult audience, carrying over the manga's dark humour and sexual undertones. These first few episodes are admirably weird, as Lupin fights crime bosses, battles a deadly magician, competes in an F1 race, and escapes from prison, even if we're never quite sure why. Despite Lupin being a master thief, there isn't much emphasis on his actually stealing stuff. Lupin's constant, vaguely psychedelic adventures are also a little mean-spirited. Although played for laughs, the violence is often graphic, and sex, while not actually shown, is never far away. Fair enough if this is your first exposure to the franchise, but this darker edge often comes as a shock to those familiar with later portrayals of Lupin as a kinder, more gentlemanly figure. A more appropriate comparison for the beginning of this series might be first Lupin feature film The Secret of Mamo, a darker, more action-oriented tale in which our heroes are constantly at each other's throats. Don't run away, I know a lot of people hate that one, but there is a definite similarity, particularly in the unflattering portrayal of the characters. For example, during the series, Lupin's code of honour isn't much in evidence, and Jigen has a nasty habit of shooting people in the back. Goemon is initially Lupin's enemy, and their relationship remains extremely tense even after he joins the gang. Fujiko fares the worst of all, however, coming across like a cold and cynical honey trap, unafraid to exploit Lupin's desires for her own ends, and rarely showing him any real affection other than when she needs saving. Hardly the most endearing bunch of characters, I'm sure you'll agree. Nevertheless, trouble was already brewing in TV land, and some drastic changes were on the horizon. Viewing figures for this new series were so poor that the original director, Masaki Ozumi, was sacked after only two of his episodes had been broadcast. One can only assume it was not a happy occasion. But Brought in to replace him were two men you may have heard of, Isao Takahata and Hayao Miyazaki. 14 years later, they would found Studio Ghibli, and the rest, as they say, is history. For now though, their remit was to change Lupin's direction, and that they did. From episode 8 onwards, the violence is toned down, mostly, the innuendo goes out the window, and the characters undergo an abrupt change. Any suggestion that Lupin may have ties with underworld gangs is dropped, Jigen becomes less of an arse, Fujiko especially becomes a far more positive character as her rivalry with Lupin becomes much more playful, her malicious streak disappears, and she starts to rely on her wits rather than sheer sex appeal. Surprisingly, even Goemon lightens up a bit. So they're no longer wild and weird, but Lupin's Pink Panther-style escapades in the second half of the series are tremendously good fun. He mugs and grins his way through endless harebrained heists, always locked in a perpetual battle of wits with his old nemesis, Inspector Zenigata. Lupin's also far more altruistic, often turning outlaw hero to take on the more serious and sinister villains he encounters along the way. It's consistently entertaining, but I thought the particular standout episodes were Lupin being blackmailed into robbing an armoured car in exchange for the life of a young girl, and Lupin's face-off against a brash French detective, which culminates in a barmy invasion of Lupin lookalikes. Established fans should also appreciate a few interesting hints as to how Miyazaki's vision might later develop, particularly in the story about a master counterfeiter hiding in an old clock tower. Lupin is a nice man. So why then should you want to watch this series all the way through? It's definitely a season of two very different halves. I'm not suggesting the first batch of episodes are bad, simply that they're very different to what you might expect. There's a freeform strangeness to them that's quite compelling, but I doubt they'll be to everyone's taste. On the other hand, some people accuse the latter half of dumbing down, reducing the plot to Saturday morning cartoon fare and doing away with what makes it special. But those people are mad and wrong. Even at this early point in time, Miyazaki and Takahata bring a magic touch to their episodes, imbuing them with a giddy energy that can't fail to put a smile on your face. I know that some people can be put off by the episodic format, and in fairness, it would be wrong to expect the level of sophisticated storytelling you'll find in Miyazaki's later work. There's no real attempt to develop the characters or involve them in anything grander than half an hour allows. Perhaps if the series had enjoyed a longer run, we might have seen some inkling of the gradual character development often seen in other shows running a similar format, but as it is, the series is content to entertain, and does that very well. Visually, there's no escaping the limitations of the time, but I think the series has aged quite well all the same. While the animation is often jerky by today's standards, and there are some curious expressions on the characters' faces, the design work still looks fresh. In part, this is probably down to how little the character designs have actually changed over the years, but they still have a pleasing look about them which is soft yet still realistic. No doubt helped by the considerable attention to detail in real-life elements such as vehicles and weaponry. The series' music also deserves special mention. While Yuji Ono's well-known theme tune did not arrive until the second series, this version boasts a distinctive jazzy score, enlivened by Morricone-style whistling, and some baffling yet curiously appropriate English lyrics. Ironically though, much as I enjoyed it, I'd hesitate to recommend this first series to anyone not already familiar with the Lupin franchise. So many writers and directors have worked on Lupin over the years that each incarnation feels different from the last, but most will fall somewhere between the two you'd encounter here. Personally, I'd suggest starting with Miyazaki's own Castle of Cagliostro, as it's a readily available work which stands on its own and also has my vote as being the greatest anime film ever made. Once you've seen that though, this series could well be a perfect follow-up. Not only is the first half a handily bite-sized introduction to the darker themes you'll find in Lupin's many subsequent outings, but the second half also contains more of that wonderful proto-Ghibli goodness. Ultimately, if you're still in any doubt about what to expect here, all you have to know is that many episodes end with Lupin simultaneously escaping from the mob, the police, and frequently his trousers. Despite occasional dabblings in psychedelia, the series is at heart always a frothy crime comedy that's not to be taken seriously. So, as long as you already have at least a vague notion of who Lupin is, I can highly recommend checking this one out.